Coming up, we look at how Microsoft is transforming virtual desktop delivery by separating operating system, user profile, and app layers to radically simplify IT management while improving the user experience. We're also going to show you how we've improved the remote experience with Microsoft Teams using Windows Virtual Desktop. And if you're a large organization using NetApp technology, we're going to show you how you can quickly bring your local file shares into Azure without losing fidelity or changing user behavior. So I'm joined once again by the engineering leader for Windows Virtual Desktop, Scott Manchester. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me back, Jeremy.
So the good news here is we're out of preview. Congratulations. And Windows Virtual Desktop, our fully managed desktop virtualization solution on Azure, is now generally available.
Thanks, Jeremy. And hopefully folks that are watching have had a chance to go hands-on with Windows Virtual Desktop by now. So as of today, you can now actually run production workloads of apps and remote desktops using WVD.
Right, but for your team, the job's never done. And really, as a service, Windows Virtual Desktop is on this cycle of continuous innovation. I know there's a lot of work that the team's been doing and the team's really been focused on since the last time we had you on the show, just a few months back.
Yeah, we've been really busy, Jeremy. We've been focused on the user experience improvements, but some of the most significant enhancements have been focused on breaking down the composition of the Windows experience itself. Now, across the user data, applications, and OS layers. On a physical device, these layers are intrinsically linked, and the user experience is consistent every time the user logs in. Their apps, data, and Windows experience is tied together. In an optimized virtualization environment, a brokering service routes a user to a virtual machine from a host pool to a VM with the resources available to host that user's app or desktop workloads. And this is likely a different virtual machine every time they log in.
Right, and I think one of the challenges here that I think a lot of people have built and with their virtual desktop environments is that they want to reproduce what's on the physical machine and that device, really minimize their overhead in terms of maintaining an environment that looks and feels like this.
Exactly, and we've already provided a mechanism for users to separate out the data by managing the user profiles with FSLogic technologies. Now, with FSLogic, we've separated the user profile layer from the virtual machine, and the way we do that lets users work in a way that feels natural. To the user, it feels like you're saving and accessing files from a local disk, but really it's a separate virtual disk hosted on a file share that we can mount to any virtual machine the user logs into. Now that separates out one of the three layers, the user profile, but you still have the app and OS layers now deeply tied together. Now in a shared or pooled virtual machine, this is a challenge because each user might need a different set of apps, and as we mentioned before, they can be assigned to a different VM each time they log in. So you're left with a couple of options. Manage a bunch of unique VM pools customized for different users' roles, and these images would all need to be individually maintained and patched. Another option is to overload the VM images with more apps than any single user would need, and then hide and block unneeded apps with policies. Now this makes your OS image bigger than it needs to be, and app licensing can get tricky. Then one more common practice is to stream apps dynamically on demand or on login. But that requires some or all of the apps to get cached into the OS during the user session, and this slows down apps' first load time. And it usually requires the IT admin to repackage or sequence the app, and you need to manage the app streaming infrastructure.
And I think these are all pretty common approaches in terms of how we deliver the experiences out for users and really do the imaging part of it, but how do we then solve for this to make it better?
What if the apps worked like the user profile and were stored outside the VM and each app attached itself like we attach the virtual disk of the user profile. And you didn't need to move app binaries into the VM, removing the need for app sequencing or streaming.
So you're saying the apps are sitting outside of the virtual machine, stored somewhere else as kind of separate entities or packages that stay there.
Yep, and that's exactly what we've built. And we call it app attach. Like we did with the user profile, we've modified Windows so the apps can be stored off the Windows disk. And we just need to attach the apps to the VM. Now, app groups are assigned to users, and they're available instantly on login because you don't have to stream the app binaries. And it looks and feels local to the user and to Windows.
Right, and what all this ultimately means, too, is that the OS layer is left clean. There's not an app payload or user profiles attached to it. Can you show us what the user experience might look like then with app attach?
Sure, let me show you the app attach experience here on my machine. So first off, Jeremy, I want you to note the size of the free available space
I have here on the disk. It looks like about 28 gigs.
Yeah, so I'm going to minimize this now. And we're going to be building this whole app attach experience natively into the Windows Virtual Desktop management experience. But for now, I'm going to run some PowerShell. But before I do, I want to prove to you that I don't have Power BI installed. So pull this up here, undo a search, and you can see no Power BI. Okay. So I'm actually going to app attach Power BI. And I chose this application because it's relatively large. It's about 400 megs compressed, and expands to about 1.2 gig on disk. Mm-hmm. Now, the other cool thing about Power BI, it's already packaged in an MSIX package, and it's available on the store. Right. So it's already completed. So I've actually installed the application now, or okay. attached the application. And if I click the Start button, you can see a recently added app. Here is Power BI. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to quickly move over and show you the C drive. The size on disk hasn't changed at all.
Still 28 gigs.
So I've got this 1.2 gig Power BI app now attached to this VM. So let's go ahead and run it. Now, to the end user and to the operating system, this looks and feels just like any other app that would have been pre-installed.
And again, the binaries are sitting off the disk of the virtual machine.
That's right. So there it is. Power BI launches to the user, looks and feels like the native experience. And you'll also note that it already has my user profile assigned to it because we mounted the app and my user profile together into this composited version of Windows here.
Very cool. So how does this differ then from traditional app layering?
Well, traditional app layering is a great tool to optimize a virtualization environment, but we have taken things a step further with App Attach. We've made core changes to Windows to support dynamic delivery of MSIX packages. Now, this is a new app delivery standard. Your existing MSIs and XEs can also be converted to MSIX as well. And we're also working with partners who are already adding support for App Attach to their existing app layering technologies.
So this is really going to help in terms of the admin experience by reducing the number of images, the image size, also keeping the OS and apps up to date for the user. It also felt like it was just their personal desktop with a local profile and local set of apps. No change in terms of the user behavior. Speaking of which, with Microsoft Teams and Unified Communications clients, there's always some challenge there in terms of remote desktop. What have we done there to make that experience better?
Yeah, as you mentioned, unified communication applications like Teams are a real challenge within virtualized environments because you're adding a second hop. So I'm connecting from my machine to the virtual machine in the cloud and then to the end user on the other side. And that can cause latency and other bad experiences. So let me show you what that looks like using a virtualization environment here. Okay. So let's make a call with Teams and see what it looks like in the before example.
Okay, so I'm going to join the call.
Hey, Jeremy.
Hey there. So I'll go ahead and start moving in front of my camera, and you can already start to see probably a little bit of the latency in terms of me bringing my image up into a VM through Teams, back to another VM, and then back to your machine.
Yeah, we've all experienced these situations where we're trying to have a high fidelity conversation with that added latency. It becomes very awkward and just isn't very functional for users. Right. And also, if you've got, you know, a microphone and audio next to each other, the echo cancellation doesn't work very well. That added latency kind of throws a damper on that.
That's right. Nobody really wants to hear their voice come back from somebody else's machine and back into their machine. So how do we then make this better with Windows Virtual Desktop?
So let me show you what we've done here. So let me get out of this call here. And I'm going to quit out of Teams. Now again, this is an early preview, so I'm going to run some script here that's going to enable AV redirection. So let me run this little script.
Looks like you're just writing a couple of reg keys, and this is again, first look. This is something that's not part of a preview or something.
Yeah, this will be built directly into Teams and will be supported with Windows Virtual Desktop. So I'm going to relaunch Teams now. So let's try that same call now with AV redirection turned on.
Okay, so there's the call. I'm going to go ahead and accept. My image should pop up in just a second there. All right, so now you've got a camera feed of my image here, and I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing. I'm going to wave in front of the camera. You can see also in terms of my latency of talking and speech, it's pretty close from what I'm doing in real time to what you're seeing on your device.
Yeah, this is a much better experience, and this is pretty much the same thing you'd see in a traditional bare metal environment, just two machines connecting up over Teams.
So it's obviously way faster and way higher fidelity, but how did the team get that to work?
Well, in the before environment, we were taking the AV stream, and it was being sent from your device to the host VM, where it is getting encoded and decoded multiple times before it gets to the other end of the call. And obviously, that latency reduces the quality and performance of your video. Now, re-encoding on your VM is also CPU intensive and could impact other users who might also be on that machine. Now, with AV redirection for Teams, we essentially redirect the Teams AV traffic to bypass the Windows Virtual Desktop virtual machine and send the audio and video data directly to one call client to the other. So in our example, my Surface is sending and receiving video data directly from the caller instead of relying on a remoted screen from a distant VM. Now, all this is done through WebRTC. It's like a direct connection between your laptop and my laptop.
And again, this is much more efficient in terms of passing the AV feed between our two clients here.
Yeah, and speaking of clients, let me show you some other work that we've done to improve the client experience.
Okay.
So here I have our brand new Windows Virtual Desktop client. And I'll show you a couple of new features here. If I go to the little wheel here, you can see I can turn on light or dark mode, which I love, the new dark mode. Mm-hmm. I also now have the ability to set specific settings of different machines or host pools that I'm connecting to. So if I right-click on this icon here, you can see that I can use the default settings. Or if I turn the default settings off, I can do things like allow the VM to resize as I resize the window. Let me show you what that looks like here. So let me go back to this VM. And I'm going to just hit the arrow here. And you'll notice as I drag the window size that the VM, as soon as I let go, the VM will stabilize to that resolution. So if I wanted to have multiple windows on my desktop and have multiple machines I could quickly switch between, I can do this. And it's really easy for me to just go back to full screen as well. In addition to these end user experiences, we've also provided some tools for IT admins. We've now made it so the app can be installed on a per user basis or a per machine basis. This allows an IT admin to enable the end users without admin privileges to be able to take updates to the application. And we've also given the IT admin controls, so they can control the velocity of updates that are coming to the client app as well.
These are going to be really welcome changes for both end users as well as admins. Really good stuff here. But to help move to a fully managed desktop virtualization service in Azure, why don't we switch gears and talk about what you do in terms of moving file shares, maybe from an on-prem environment into Azure. What are some things we can do there?
Yeah, if you're migrating from an on-prem environment to Azure, you'll want to move your file shares as well to keep your data as close as it can be to the virtual machines.
Right, and so we've shown Azure Files previously in Microsoft Mechanics, and it's a great solution in terms of supporting Azure Active Directory domain services. But if you're on an on-prem Active Directory and really need a simple option to move your file share volumes as is, kind of like the volume level backup, into Azure and maintain their paths, all the permissions, all of the stuff around NTFS, you can do that using Azure NetApp Files to save time. Now, what this does here is two different things. First, it's allowing you to lift and shift your shared volumes into Azure NetApp Files. And you can see here when I click in, I've got a couple of what are called capacity pools. Now, the capacity pool is actually a volume. In my case, it's 4 terabytes, and that's where you can start. And if I click into the volumes, you can see a volume here. And when I click into that, you'll see the SMB path to be able to reach that volume if I'm on a domain join machine, which is right here. Now, when I switch over to a domain join machine, it's just like managing a file share like you would do on premises, but this is in Azure now. So if I look at my network, I can see my SMB path. If I click into the volume in the file share itself, that folder, I'll go and I see more folders. In our case, they're user profiles. We can click the properties of that folder. And just like I would any other security tab in a Windows File Explorer, I can add permissions to it. In this case, I'll go ahead and type Enterprise Admins. And I'm going to check the names there, give permissions to that group. I can give it full control and apply everything just like it's running my on-prem file servers, but now it's all in Azure. We've basically wired up the connectivity between the two environments, and you can see there's my set of folders. So everything looks and feels just like it normally would, but again, these files are located in Azure.
Yeah, this is a really simple way now to lift and shift your file shares up into Azure. And you can do this now and both manage your FSLogic profiles and your AppAttach profiles in this file share.
That's a really great point. So you can see how we're really transforming virtual desktop delivery, as well as all the improvements around remote experiences for things like Microsoft Teams. But what's next, Scott? I know you're never done, right?
Well, we're going to continue to make improvements to the user experience. So working on that user experience within the remote desktop client application, as well as building additional tools for IT admins to manage their Windows Virtual Desktop environment.
So lots of really great technologies here, but if I want to get started with Windows Virtual Desktop, where do I get started?
Well, customers can get started today. You can go to aka.ms/WVD and get all the documentation and information you need to start your production deployment.
Thanks, Scott. And by the way, one more tip, if you need help getting deployed, we've got a how-to series on Microsoft Mechanics at aka.ms/WVD playlist. Of course, don't forget to hit subscribe. And from the WMTC here in Washington State, thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.